Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. This morning, we are now going to look at the eighth of the Beatitudes, and some have suggested that it's the last of the Beatitudes, but in reality, what we find in these three powerful chapters, 5, 6, and 7 of Matthew, is really God's great instruction manual, God's manual for building a Christian the right way. And you know what? There's always something good about knowing that. As you complete the manual, as you do what God tells you to do, you are building a Christian to function according to design. No parts are left over. No screws are loose. Amen? That's always good. And you know what? As we have looked at these, starting in verse 3, we've considered, in fact, what the Lord, in fact, was interested in as He builds you in faith, in obedience with Him. It's intriguing that he begins with the premise of poverty in spirit in verse 3. But it's interesting also that as we look this morning at verses 10 through 12, we see that the product of being joyful in persecution is the same as being joyful in poverty of spirit, because God offers us. The reward is that we will be given the kingdom of heaven. Jesus said, "You want to be happy? You will do the things that will bring about the world's anger against you. You will do the things that will bring the devil's anger against you. Friends, you will do the things that will even bring your own personal flesh's anger against you." And what is that? What is it that Jesus says brings happiness, but in conjunction with that happiness is persecution? Friends, that one thing is to be righteous as Jesus is righteous. The end result of that, Jesus says, is that theirs will be the kingdom of heaven, as we read in verse 10. Jesus goes on in verse 11 to say, "Blessed are you when they revile, when they persecute, when they say all kinds of evil against you falsely." You know what, friends? There's no reward when someone reviles, curses, says all kinds of evil against you, and it's true. Get the idea? There's no blessing in that. There's no reward of heaven in that. But when it is false concerning you, you have lived the righteous life of representing Jesus where you are, where God has planted you, there is great blessing, and the kingdom of heaven is yours. But Jesus says, as you represent me, as you walk about where I have planted you, where you walk about and represent me where I have employed you, it is Jesus that has employed you there, in the neighborhood, in the business, in this community. Friends, there's no mistake that God has put you here. There's no mistake that God has put you here in this time for a very specific reason. And friends, it's a joyful thing to discover why God has put you here. Friends, that's the most amazing discovery any Christian can ever make. But while you are occupying until Jesus comes, in His power, in His grace, you're going to discover that these words lead us into battle. Into a very specific battle that you will never win except by the blood of Jesus Christ. And by the empowerment of His Spirit, as He equips you for this battle, you will discover that though the world will throw at you the very things of verse 11, reviling you, persecuting you, saying all kinds, that word all in the Greek means, yeah. They're going to spew anger and vehemence against you. They're going to spit at you. They're going to beat you. They even may attempt to kill you. And across this world, there are men and women who stand for Jesus. The history of the Christian church that we are blessed by today is a stance that is built upon men and women who, as martyrs, have gone to heinous, horrifying deaths at the hands of not only those in the world and of the flesh and of the devil, but at the very hands of the Christian church at times. But have done that, why? Because they're stubborn? No, but because they believe in righteousness and that Jesus has set them apart. In that time, in that place, for a specific reason, even as He has you. Most Christians were not prepared when perhaps for the first time in their lives they stood before someone that God had planted them near. For years, perhaps you wondered, why do I have to work with this blockhead? Why do I have to be around this person that cusses so much? Why do I have to be around this person that turns everything into some sexual innuendo? And so in your own strength, you ventured out and you said something with regard to Jesus, and they spat at you. They beat you. They said lies about you. They cursed at you. They reviled you. And you thought within your heart, I will never do this again. I love the Lord, but I emotionally, I can't take this. I might even lose my job for standing for Jesus. And so the world penetrated, the flesh had its way. The devil, in his deceptive work, told you, you're not a pastor, you're not a priest, you've never been to seminary, you don't know what to say, you probably messed it up anyways, that person will never come to know Jesus now, who do you think that you are, how dare you, concerning what you said when I saw you do this and do that, and cowering in a corner of life, we just did that which came natural to us, and we stepped out of the supernatural. We wonder all the time if you, like me, at a stage in my life, I wondered, how is it that there are certain men and women with such keen ability to speak into people's lives, and they hold these huge events, and they come into stadiums, into football fields, and they crowd into corners, perhaps even into heated tents in the middle of the summer of Kansas, and camp meetings and tent meetings. And people give their lives to, who are these people that have such ability? And they're no different than you and I. Peter even said of Elijah, probably the man who did more miracles than any other man except Jesus, that he was a man just like you and I. The world is attempting this very day to penetrate in a manner and a degree that probably has never been known in the history of the Christian church before. For Paul warned Timothy that in the last days, the days that we are engaged with this very day, would be recognized not outside the church, not within the bounds of the heinous, adulterous world, but rather within the boundaries of the Christian church itself, that men would be lovers of themselves. The primary motivation of anybody in the last days would be, what's in it for me? I've come to church to be blessed, not to bless. I've come to church to be recognized. I want my 15 minutes of fame. And all the while, this compulsion of life to tell your story without listening to someone else's. In this grand interest that the world has lied into our hearts about our story, our lives, our needs, we've neglected the one most powerful thing that Jesus has offered us in this world. And it's the very power of heaven. Jesus said, the weapons of our warfare, and friends, it is warfare. The weapons of our warfare, when the world spits and curses and says evil, nasty lies about you, they don't know what else to do but what they by default have been taught by the devil himself to do. And dare I say, it's so easy at times to listen to that reviling and those cursings, to listen to the way that they speak of you and the possibility that all that you own could be lost. It's possible to just back off. It's likely, it's most natural to back off and to think, you know, I've got to think of my household. I've got to think of my family. I've got to think of more things than just Jesus. And so the Christian church wonders today why seats are empty, why budgets squeak by, why a city as graceful and beautiful as Santa Maria is a city that is torn apart by selfish acts of greed and violence, of people seeking their own good. What's in it for myself, they think. And somehow, so unfortunately, I'm sure that you would agree, somehow the church has got captivated by it as well. So we have these huge events of entertainment. We're out to entertain Christians. We're not really engaged in bringing the word that is powerful, that is living, that will make in you something that you could not have made of yourself, that no entertaining event could ever have made. And somehow sparked within your mind is something that was sparked in the days just before I came to know Jesus, when a dear middle-aged woman standing on the Huntington Beach pier looked out across the beach and she saw the hippies smoking their pot and the surfers riding the waves. And suddenly she saw through the eyes of Jesus. Suddenly the compassion of the Spirit of God came within her. And she ran home and told her husband, I know what we've been called to do here in Southern California. They went forth to begin to preach. They went forth being embarrassed, being cursed at, being spat at, being made fun of. But they didn't give up. And the Jesus movement was born. The great, most recent revival in this nation, if not the entire world, was born out of somebody that just had the supernatural interest to say, why does Jesus have me here? You ever wonder that yourself? Why does Jesus have me where I'm working? Why does Jesus have me where I'm living, in this neighborhood? Why does Jesus have me in Santa Maria? Why does Jesus put me where I am around such absolutely horrifying people? and recognize that it was likely somebody that was crying that same word when they came to you or came to me, like I was approached in 1972 on the lawn in front of Ghirardelli Square in San Francisco. As I laid on the grass and partook of my partakings, a young man ventured to me and said, "Do you have peace with God?" And irrespective of the lies and the vehemence and the reviling and the hatred that spewed from my mouth, that word never left my heart. And I don't think for a moment that that man was wondering as he approached me, "I'm not Billy Graham, I'm not a pastor, I'm not a priest, I'm just a schmo in the midst of life that wonders, why does God have me here? What is it that God has engaged me in? How is it that as I look at these Beatitudes this morning, there's not a single qualification, Jesus says, with respect to your ability to debate? He doesn't say, I want the apologists of my church to go forth and witness my truth. I want the priests and the pastors, I want those that have memorized the word to go forth and represent my righteousness. But he says, no, I want those that are poor in spirit. I want those that are sorrowing over their sin. I want those that are meek. I want those that are hungering and thirsting after righteousness. I want those that give and forgive because they're merciful. They've understood what God has done for them. I want those that are peacemakers. I want those that will consider this morning why it is that you have never been persecuted, or perhaps why you gave up when the world was only doing what it knew best to do. When these people that you brought this kind word or this word of faith to only did that they knew best to do. Friends, Jesus is guaranteeing you. He is saying to you, be assured of this, that they will revile you. They will persecute you. They will say all kinds of evil against you. But it will be false for my name's sake. Rejoice, he says in verse 12, and be exceedingly glad. It's a word that comes from Greek that actually describes somebody leaping for joy. It's not like, wow, I think I'm glad right now. It means that they're running, they're jumping, they're actually dancing for joy, because they had the blessing of being spat upon. Who's ready to sign up for that? Who's ready to say in this world, I'm ready for that? None of us are. I don't know how to teach you to preach His word. It's not my job to. I don't know how to prepare you to be like Jesus where He has put you. It's not my job. It's Jesus' job. It's the Spirit of the Holy Ghost, and He has said to us, even while you stand before the courts of this world, I will speak into your heart the very things to say at the moment that you are in the battle. Some would say 6 months is a long time to wait. But for 6 months, the Word of God, the idea, do you have peace with God, it burned in my heart. Weeks after that, I was living in Oakland at the time. It's hard for me to admit, but I went to take my life. Because there was no peace in my life. And I didn't know what to do with it. I drove by churches on Sunday mornings and wondered, what is it they're so happy about? But God had a plan. He had a man that would come into my life, and irrespective of my spitting, my reviling, my persecution, my cursing, my lying concerning his life, he stood stand fast. He spoke the word, and the love of God set me free. It wasn't him. It won't be you. It's Jesus. And this morning, friends, rather than out of a heart of indifference, listen, he's asking you to come back to the front lines. He's asking you as the Church of Jesus Christ, come back and be the happiest person. Because when you become my righteousness, when you let me fill your life, when you let me speak through you, you're going to discover that in the midst of all the world that the world throws at you, you will find the greatest joy you have ever discovered in your life previous to now. The devil, from this very moment, is going to attempt to do everything possible to convince you you're not qualified. You don't have the goods. And I want you just right now to say to Jesus, thank you, because I am not qualified. I do not have the goods. I do not have the intellect. I do not have the words. I do not have the strength. But I know he who does. And as the video said, Jesus is really good at being God. So I'm asking you this morning, would you make the venture with me today to turn this city upside down? Would you venture with me with those that God has planted and salted in your experience? Listen, Jesus said the fields are white for harvest. All I'm looking for are laborers. All I'm looking for is somebody that will represent me, an ambassador, as it were. Somebody that will just speak the word. Maybe it's a single word, maybe it's a single sentence, but know this, it will burn in the hearts of those that hear it. Until all they can do is come lying before the throne of grace and see Jesus set another captive free. Listen, from the very prison that God released you from, he's asking you today, I want you to go back. I want you to go back to the place that you were captivated. I want you to go back to the life and the people living it. And I want you to speak the words that set people free, because those are the words that set you free. And leave it to Jesus. Leave it to Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father, in Jesus' name, I believe that God is calling this church to bring about, with many other churches, the next great revival in this nation. But Father, I'm not responsible for Chicago, Cincinnati, Miami, San Francisco, Los Angeles. I'm not responsible for any other neighborhood but my own. I'm not responsible for any other place of employment but the one that you've invested me in, Lord God. I don't know why you have me here. I don't know why you've invested me in where I work, Lord God. You might be saying that this morning. But Jesus does. He has put you there for a purpose, an amazing supernatural purpose that he has designed simply for you. You, where you are, what you are, what you've become. And Father, in Jesus' name, raise a church up, Lord God. In Jesus' name, would you revive this army to put on the full armor of God? Would you revive this army, oh Jesus? We know what's before us, but revive this army, Lord God, to step back into the foxhole. We know what's coming. They're going to hate us, but we will not quit. They're going to revile us, but we will not give up. They're going to spit upon us and lie about us, but we will not quit, Jesus, because someone didn't quit for me. Father, I'm asking you, Jesus, in this place, in this day, in this hour, Lord God, raise up an army of blood-bought, born-again Christians that will simply do what Jesus will invest them to do at the moment, at the location, and set people free. Father, we pray for your Holy Spirit. We pray for your anointing, Lord God. Every one of us here, we pray, Lord Jesus, that this day would be a day that separates any other day that has come before it. And that in years to come, we will look back if Jesus tarries and we will recognize that Jesus did something on the fourth day of December that changed the life of Santa Maria, California. Jesus wants to do it through you. Please, Lord, lead us to let you, we pray, in your holy name. Amen and amen. Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in His Spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.